What's going on, ladies and gentlemen? Thank you so much for tuning in. It's me, Mikey Pipes. And today, we are on top of the Woodmere, New York post office. Asking you shall receive. I have been doing tons of direct mailing and marketing, drumming up more commercial business. The postmaster said, Mikey Pipes, we got a rooftop unit that needs maintenance. And I'm like, one rooftop unit? That's one. That's two. And that's three. Man, three rooftop units here for this building. Wow. This is insane. I'm saying it's insane because we have a front lobby area where there's the post office boxes. We have the lobby, the retail lobby, and we have the rear mail processing area space. And all together, we probably have around 3,000 square feet. It's about double the size of our shop. And they got three rooftop units. And if you think that's excessive, right? Wait until I show you the brand new Whale McLean oil-fired boiler that services, and I kid you not, 125 feet of slant fin number 30 baseboard. You're not gonna wanna miss this. So we have a 120,000 BTU system. This is a 10 ton. Oh, it says it right there. 30 tons. 10 tons, right? Hold on. 10 tons, and they're fairly new, and we already got all that nice, good, nasty stuff growing on the coil. 20. 30. 30 tons of cooling. Wow. 30 tons of cooling. You know what? I have to be wrong. I am going to do a quick measurement of this roof, and we're going to see how many square feet this building is. This is disgusting, by the way. And this is why, and I don't want to get political right now, but this is why we need a commander-in-chief to rid of the waste and fraud in the federal government. This is disgusting. The fact that I got to pay 69 cents to mail a first-class envelope to anyone in the U.S., right? And it's still a deficit with the U.S. government, post office. And someone installed three 10-ton systems for this building is disgusting. Absolutely disgusting. All right, I was very, very wrong with the square footage. I'm just keeping it real. Front to back, 80 feet. Left to right, 90 feet. That's 7,200 square feet.
Still says about 150,000 BTUs.
150,000 BTUs. We are grossly oversized. Grossly oversized. And the fact that there are three fairly brand new rooftop units here, and you know they're gas equipped because I got the exhaust right here for our gas inducer motor. Oh yeah. That is the gas valve that I have my finger in where the gas comes into it. Disgusting. Anyway, let's do some maintenance and service. All right, the proper way to clean any HVAC coil, regardless if it's the condensing coil or the evaporator coil, you always want to wash and rinse from the inside out, because when the system is running, the air is coming from the outside in. Keep that in mind, ladies and gentlemen. And that means that sometimes you got to get inside the unit. Hi, Daniel. All right, for our chemical, we're using NuCalgon, their NuBrite. This is the number one coil cleaner in the HVACR industry. And it's for professional use only. Daniel right now is applying the chemical on the inside of the condensing coil. He's wearing his PPE. You gotta protect your hands and your face because the stuff does burn.
This side you can't really see it as much.
Yeah.
But the other side you can see it pulling off the black, I guess from the roof, like right up here.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah, it's
not crazy dirty,
but still dirty. And this is why when you call Pipe Doctor Home Services for your commercial rooftop HVAC package unit, we leave no stone unturned. We are going to wash your coils. Is your HVAC contractor doing the same? It's a little hard to see, but it has a slight tint of brown to it in the water. It's not crazy dirty, but I don't know if they actually properly cleaned this last season. There was another HVAC R contractor that came here twice a year, one time in the fall. Yeah, look at that dirt coming out of there. Wow, that's good stuff right there. So this other HVAC R company came out here, but we started servicing the building for their backflow prevention device. And just by asking the postmaster, like, hey, you know, we also do rooftop units. Wow, look at all that dirt. Woo! Yeah. Yeah, wow, that's a good money right there. That's a good money shot. Right, wow. Huh. Yeah. Crazy.
Okay, I'm gonna go to the left side.
I don't know if you guys can see it, but it's dark, but not like crazy dark. And ladies and gentlemen, all that dirt, that's going to interfere with heat transfer when it's running in cooling mode. And you're going to have increased runtime, increased compressor wear and tear, and insufficient cooling. You'll increase your head pressure.
Oops, sorry.
Okay. Move out of the way. Keep my feet dry. Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Incredible. I'd like to give a shout out to Hughes Man HVAC. He runs the Misfits After Dark, right? Is that what he runs?
Misfits of HVAC.
Misfits of HVAC. I'm a Misfit. I've been on there. So is Daniel.
After Dark is good now. They're
yeah, After Dark, they're crazy. They really are. But those are the hardcore refrigeration guys.
Yeah.
Those guys are killing it, by the way. Those guys are killing it. But you know what sucks? 2 o'clock in the morning when it's 10 degrees outside and you got to shovel out the snow of a rooftop unit to get to it.
Yeah.
That sucks.
Hughes Man does that.
Yeah. I'd rather stick with, you know, air conditioning and not refrigeration. Yeah, microchannel coils do suck.
It's gonna rinse out internally.
Yep. So we're gonna take quite some time here rinsing this, ladies and gentlemen. We wanna get all that chemical off the coil, but most importantly, we want all that dirt off the coil. Take your time, ladies and gentlemen. This is not a 20-minute job. We're gonna be here for a few hours. Servicing 2 out of 3 units. All right, so while Daniel is working on still rinsing that coil, I'm checking out this other unit. And when I took off the access cover to expose the compressors, the refrigeration piping, our service ports, our pressure switches, our controls, power's off, I'm noticing this and the greenness on our refrigeration tubing here going into our filter dryers, and it's like, I can't tell if it's wet or is it just oily, but this is green. And I don't know, it looks very, very suspect. Like, why is this green? I guess they believe in hand tight, huh? So I'm a little curious about that. I'm looking for any oil residue, and I just have a wet coil. It did rain yesterday and the last several days here, and the coil's kind of damp, but I don't see any oil residue on anything. So that's a good sign. you know, these microchannel coils, they're notorious for leaking. At least that's tight. Tight. Yeah, just this one was hand tight. And that one too. Well, let's take a look at our evaporator coil. Our TXVs, the metering devices. The ambient temperature sensor there. But we do got some nasty stuff growing on this thing. Not terrible. But they're dirty. Coil. Our economizer. It's all rusted up there. Interesting. It's always good to get a fresh set of eyes on things. All right. And I'm really wondering if these are shipping guards for the condensing coils, because it's on that, here, there, and they're not usually on Trane units. And none of the manuals are here. You gonna Google it? Yeah, ChatGPT, baby. Hey, Alexa, can I leave the shipping metal covers on Trane condensing coils for a commercial rooftop unit? Let's see what it says. Model YSC 120 H3RHA000. By the way, someone told me that a certain plumber who operates out of Massachusetts charges $125 a pound for R410A. Wow. We're going to up our price to $195 a pound now.
Yeah, one of the people in the WhatsApp chat, they thought that we were $175 a pound.
Yeah, maybe $175. I'll update the price in House Coal Pro. Let's see what ChatGPT says. So, yeah, we took the shipping covers off, and now we're really getting the elbow grease applied, cleaning that coil. Wow. Ooh. Wow. That's some good stuff. Yep. You get what you pay for, ladies and gentlemen. Never forget that. Can't make this up, ladies and gentlemen. We're at the Woodmere, New York post office. And another HVAC contractor used to come here twice a year to perform preventative maintenance on these rooftop units. But look at all that dirt coming out of this coil. You know what? I happen to live not too far away. And you know what? They're not this dirty. We service multiple commercial systems in a one block radius. Look at that. That was never cleaned, ladies and gentlemen. I asked the postmaster, did they ask you for the hose and the water? And she goes, no, they're in and out of here in 20 minutes, Mikey. Stealing from the U.S. federal government by not providing a service that you're charging is a felony. Man, look at that. Filthy, disgusting animals. They charge for work they don't do. Absolutely horrific.
You can see it in the bin already.
Yeah, so I'm capturing some of the water we're rinsing through. We're gonna let this settle for a second. I want you to see how dirty that water is that we're taking out of this coil.
After like two rinses already, though.
And this is after several rinses, by the way. You know, it's gray. It's a light gray color. ladies and gentlemen, if you're in the HVAC world, do the right job. Right? I know sometimes you get overwhelmed, you have too much on your schedule. Talk to management, talk to the owner of the company. Say, listen, you can't be rushed. It takes time to properly do a cleaning and maintenance on these systems. If you're in and out of a customer's location in 20 minutes, changing the filter and blowing out the drain line, you're doing a disservice for the end user, your customer, the client. And here, the client is my fellow Americans, my fellow taxpayers, and those who utilize the United States Postal Service. I'm Mikey Pipes, and I approve this message. 30. That water's dirty. Let's see if I can put it on something that's white. Yeah, I guess I could. Hold on. Let's see. You know what? It's sitting in the rain anyway. Nasty. All right, right now we're checking out our temperatures and pressures of the refrigeration circuit number one on our front 10-ton system. This 10-ton system, if you recall, services the front retail lobby, the P.O. box area, and the postmaster's office. I have the front door on. I got my wireless probes by JB, just better. They're climate class probes. The coil is still wet. As you see, water's still dripping from this. We have 110 on our low, 216 on our high. We have 25 degrees of superheat, no subcooling, suction line pressure, temperature of 60 degrees, liquid line of 124. This is on circuit one. We're gonna let this run for another 15 minutes, 10, 15 minutes. Let's see what our numbers look like, and then we'll check out circuit number two.
Temperature, and then it tells you where...
Want to add probes to this? Yes,
we can do that. No, like if you manually... Outdoor air temperature.
69 degrees.
And then, yeah, that would be good. Did I change that? These little dials?
No. I don't recall. Alright, we have 10.3 degrees, 4 degrees of subcooling. Slightly increasing, but we are quite stable. So we check circuit 2. Alright, low pressure. Right before my compressor. High pressure right after the compressor, and the clamp-on probe after the condensing coil, and this one right before it goes into the compressor. All right, she's been running for a while, so 109 and 250, 13 and a half degrees, and slowly dropping of subcooling. You like them, huh? Yeah. Better than your Fisher-Price field piece. I call field piece FP, Fisher-Price.
And the probes don't have a screen on them, do they?
Yes, they do. You don't need to use the app. They all have a screen on them, and they instantly connect.
That's nice.
Very nice. All right, we're good. All right, the customer asked me to put all the thermostat to cool and 68 degrees, so that's 3 10-ton systems at 68 degrees. Awesome.